I got a quick video for you today. I wanted to talk about shooting at ISOs lower than the base or native ISO in log on cameras that allow you to do that, like the Sony cameras. And I think there's other brands that do as well, but some brands don't. Some brands, when you try to go below the base, say it's ISO 800, it just switches to auto and you can't choose the lower sort of pseudo extended ISOs. On the Sony cameras, you can tell because these are the ones with the lines on the top and the bottom. Here, let me show you. So here I've got an A7S III, and if we go into ISO, then we can see that the native ISO in log is 640. And we can increase that up to, well, quite high on an A7S III. But you'll notice that there's also a few ISOs below 640, 500, 400, 320, 250, 200, and 160, that basically two stops below, that all have lines above and below. And these are the ISOs that we're talking about. Like I said, not all cameras even let you choose these. So what happens if you were to shoot at 400 or 200 or something like that? So first off, I just have some Xyla 21 charts because I wanted to test the dynamic range, because generally when you shoot in those lower than native ISOs, you are giving up dynamic range. So I wanted to see exactly how much. But before I give you the scores, take a look here on the waveform. So at 640, we can see that it's clipped right here, and then how many stops we get moving down, and then we can see the noise floor. And this is gonna be important as well. And I want you to look at these lower stops here as we go through. So if we switch to ISO 400, which is now one of the lower than base ones, we can see that what happened was the clipping point, the maximum point, went down a notch. And with that, if you look at this sort of fuzzy line at the bottom here, the noise also went down. It's not as noisy anymore. And if we compare to an extreme example, which is this one over here at ISO 160, we can see that the noise is very, very thin now compared to the 640 and 160. Much, much thinner amount of noise. But the way that the stops are kind of peaking up, we can see that it sort of stops here and we can't see anything past this. But if we go to this one, there are remnants. They're very noisy, but there are remnants of stops that move past this. So any stops that are more mixed into that noise floor are going to kind of disappear. And if we look at the imatest results, so the actual scores from these, we can see this. So if we start here and we look at ISO 640, and then we look over at this section here where it says slope-based DR, this number, 14.6, is the total amount of stops that it can see, regardless of noise. And then as we go down, these are varying qualities based on the signal-noise ratio. So usually we look at something like medium, which is a signal-noise ratio of 2, 12.6, it's telling us we get 12.6 clean stops, but the camera can see 14.6 total. But if we were to move down to ISO 400 here, by the way, this plus 88, that's the clipping point in camera if you were to set your zebras to what level to be the maximum white now based on that new lower ISO, that's what it'll be, is plus 88. I'll show you in the camera in a minute once we're done here. So now the total dynamic range, the total amount of stops it can see dropped to 14 from 14.6. But the medium and low scores, they stayed the same at 12.6 for clean and 13.6 for, you know, pretty clean. If we move to ISO 200 though, which now has a plus 79 for maximum clipping point, the total amount of stops we can see drops to 13.2, which also is affecting the low now. It's not affecting the medium. It says it went up a little bit, but just it's probably a margin of error. But the low is now being limited by that, which means the stops that were sort of noisy before, but you know, not as clean as medium, those used to be 13.6 all the way through, but now we can only see 13.2 of them because there's only 13.2 stops total, but we still get our 12.5-ish in the medium. And then finally, if we move all the way down to ISO 160, which is the lowest we can set the ISO, the total amount of stops that you get to work with period is 12.8, which means that the low is also 12.8, and the medium, again, could be up to 12.8 maximum. And what's interesting is that they're all the same now, which makes me think that it's kind of calibrated probably, so that when you set the ISO as low as possible, that it's going to give you only the stops that have a signal noise ratio of 2, like the clean stops, which is what the medium is showing here. So you can just sort of trim off the extra noisy ones, reduce the noise, and get rid of those stops if you want by lowering the ISO down. And the lowest clipping point for ISO 160 is plus 76. Let me show you what that means in the camera if, say, you use zebras to expose on these Sony cameras. Okay, so as you can see in the bottom of the frame there, it's ISO 640. And if we go into our zebras, where it says lower limit 94 plus, that is the correct clipping point for S-Log 3. Each gamma is different. And you can always tell which one it is by just moving up and down. If you have your zebras set too high like this, the zebras won't show up. So you can bring them down one at a time. Make sure you're pointing at something that's clipped, like pointing at a bright light or something. And you bring it down one at a time. And as soon as you get the 94 plus, the zebras will appear. So that's how you can sort of find out what the clipping point is for the gamma that you're on. What's the highest number that the zebras will appear on? And if they disappear going up one, bring it back. That's the clipping point. But if we had this set to, so say we go in here and we lower ISO down to 500, for example. There's a quick and easy way to remember this. As you go over to this, you have to drop it by 3 points. Each 1/3 stop of ISO requires you to lower your maximum clipping point in your zebras by 3 points. So then now it would be like this. 92 would not show zebras, and the 91, the zebras would magically come back when you were at ISO 500. If we lower the ISO down to 400, same thing. It's a pattern. We're going to go over here now. 88. If we lower the ISO down to 320, again, same thing, 85. If we lower the ISO to 250, and again, if you have a camera that starts at a different base ISO, a Sony camera that is, so say it's 800, the same principles apply. It's just that you're gonna start ticking down from 800 and you'll still end up at the same bottom point, but your bottom will now be ISO 200 instead of 160. Okay, so now let's take all this information and apply it to an actual scene so we can see how it works when you're actually shooting something. So in this clip here, the area right here that I'm pointing at with my finger, this zone right here is clipped. It has zebras on it when I shot it, but over here is fine, the rest of the building, just right there. And if we look at the waveform, we can see what I'm talking about. The rest of it is just below the line, and then this bit right here is clipped. If you were to try to shoot this building, let's say, and this is at ISO 800, and then you brought it down to ISO 400, what's gonna happen? Are you still gonna be clipped here, or all of a sudden you're not gonna be clipped? Because if you move from, say, ISO 1600 to 800, you would no longer be clipping that section. But are you still clipping it if you move down from ISO 800 to 400? The answer is yes, you are. However, the clipping point is now lowered, like we talked about. You don't recover any highlights, and I think that's important for you to remember, is if you turn down the ISO below a native ISO, you don't recover highlights. You would if you were shooting higher than native. If you went from 1600 to 800, you would bring some highlight information back, but not if you go from 800 down to 400. All that's happening is the whole scene is being pushed down. So what would be the reason for actually doing this? Well, if you were to monitor this shot or grade it, or you knew what your intention was in post, you can see that the ISO 200, once I apply the standard Sony Rec 709 LUT, is now really nicely exposed. Again, this spot is still gonna be clipped. It's not gonna change anything, but the scene is as it was seen on the day, like as it should be shown. But as you can see, the ISO 400 and the ISO 800 are overexposed now with the LUT applied, and they don't look good at all. So you have to go in and you have to apply an offset manually before the LUT to reduce them to equal exposures. And when you do that, now the shots are pretty much the same. So what if instead we expose for middle gray perfectly? What's happening to the stops at the top and the bottom? I showed you the dynamic range if we expose to the right and see how many we can see into the shadows. What happens if we expose perfectly in the middle? So if we look here, this is ISO 800, and I exposed for middle gray to be the middle of the chart, and then we can see when it clips off to the left, like at what stop it clips, and what happens in the shadows. And so let's take a look at the waveform there. We can see that there's 4 stops on the brighter side that are clipped, and then we can see the rest of the shape and how it curves down. But if we look at ISO 400, now there's an extra stop that's clipped. So bringing it down ISO 400, like I said, doesn't preserve any highlights. If you expose to the middle, those building shots were also exposed to the right. So keep that in mind, okay? But now we're exposed to the middle. So when you expose to the right, you don't bring any more highlights back. If you expose to the middle and you bring down the ISO, you actually have fewer highlights to work with because of the fact that the maximum clipping point is moving down on you. So again, ISO 800, we can get this stop. ISO 400, that stop is gone. The rest of the curve, though, you'll notice is pretty similar. And I'd say it maintains that here. It just, we lose this stop. But in exchange, again, go back to 800. Look how thick the noise is. You can see right here. And at 400, a lot less noise. So we're basically trading off this stop for less noise. And ISO 200, we lose another stop yet again. So now we have 6 stops that are clipped, but the noise becomes even less so. But the curve here remains the same throughout each of them. So what does that mean then if we shoot a scene exposed to the middle that has, you know, different values in it? So here, as you can see, this is my scene shot at ISO 800, and I exposed to middle grade of 41%, which is the by the book way to expose S-Log3. And if we move to ISO 400, very little is changing. And there's a reason for that. Those extreme stops that are getting clipped in the Xyla 21 test, they don't really show up here. Because remember, we still get, you know, 12 and a half stops to work with. The noise is the biggest difference. Let's go to ISO 800 and we'll zoom in right over here. This is usually hard to show on YouTube, so I'm gonna punch in to a crazy percentage. So we're like 400 or 500% now. Do you see the sort of pattern here? Watch as I click to ISO 400 and then ISO 200. You see how there's less of it? And obviously if we play a little bit versus play a little bit over here, this is the regular noise level. This is ISO 800. This is the, you know, the native ISO, and then 400 and then 200. So 200 is a very, very low noise, much lower than 800. And it's actually lower than the noise if you do the typical overexpose and bring it down trick, which I thought was the most interesting. So here is two shots. This is ISO 400, and just use a light and you grade it a little bit. And then this is ISO 4000, which is way, way, way overexposed, like maximum overexposure, and then brought down and then graded that way. So same deal, we're gonna zoom in over here, really, really, really far zoomed in. So this is ISO 4000, it's very, very clean. And then ISO 400 is slightly worse. But it was the closest comparative I could find, was sort of one stop below the native is similar to massively overexposing. So I flip back and forth, you can see that the 400 is slightly worse. But the 200, two stops below native, is slightly better than the 4000 ISO extreme overexposure. So I thought that was interesting. Now, if we try to wrap all this up and, you know, conclude with what do I do with this information then practically? Basically, just know the limits, know what you're doing. So can you lower the ISO below the native and get away with it? Yes, of course. In fact, if you're shooting in a controlled setting where you need, you know, 12 stops or fewer, it's not going to be an issue. Unless all your stops are, you need to be way up in the clipping point, then you're going to want to expose to the right. But if you expose neutrally and your whole scene will fit in that, you know, 5-6 stops above and below, then it really doesn't matter. You can just lower the ISO to get a darker image and less noise. And it works. There is less noise in the image. The trade-off, obviously, is that for, you know, each stop of noise that you reduce, you're losing a stop of highlights, which kind of makes sense and it seems like a fair trade-off. But you'll never lose more than the amount of clean stops the camera can see anyway at a signal noise ratio of 2, which in the case of the A7S III is that 12 and a half stops, which I think is kind of interesting that you'll never lose more than the 12 and a half stops. And then you just have to expose with how much light you're letting into the camera to light the scene the way that you want. And like you saw in the case of the sky here, sometimes it can make your workflow a lot easier because maybe you're monitoring and you're like, oh, I didn't bring an ND or whatever. Okay, I'll just drop my ISO down to 200 and you've got the LUT applied, so you're previewing the LUT. You're like, yeah, looks good. Okay, I don't see any issues with that because I'm not really worried about, like, in my shot with the sky in the building, the shadows are slightly different in that corner because maybe we're starting to encroach beyond the, you know, the 12 and a half stops and we're starting to see some of the more noisy stops being allowed in there. But that's the type of difference that we're talking about here, is this versus this. Like, yes, you can see a slight difference in the shadows, but it is slight. So basically, I just think it's a tool you can use and know when and how to use it. And it's great to know that while, yes, you are giving up dynamic range, some of the old things I read of like, if you shoot below the native ISO, your camera's just, you know, throw it in the garbage, basically. It's not that bad. You are giving up dynamic range, but you're never giving up more than what your clean signal noise ratio of 2 stops is going to be anyway. And I think that's pretty good. That's a good result. So I don't know. Do with this what you want. I hope that it was helpful. Yeah. All right. I'm done.